Bose PS321. Woofer adaptation. This is the documentation of the experience of a hobby project, made with the hope that it could be helpful to others. But any comment that could help me to improve my practice is also welcome and appreciated. Unlike other videos in this series, this particular one shows a very simple adaptation process, and there is no extra written documentation attached to it. Bose PS321 is an audio system composed of a woofer, a couple of smaller size loudspeakers, and a hub for connecting and managing various sources of sound that is called the media center. The original documentation defines the whole set as a home entertainment system. The woofer contains autonomous power supply and amplification, but it is made for interacting only with the media center using a 15-pin D-sub connector and a proprietary cable. This video is about making the woofer fully autonomous in case the media center were not available anymore and there were no other options left than just disposing of this unit. However, one should know that there are different versions of this home entertainment system, which means that the technical specification may differ significantly or even be fully incompatible with the unit considered in this video. In other words, if you are following along, you are doing so at your own risk. The proposed modification could destroy the unit and/or provoke any other type of unknown damage, including harming people. The documentation that is necessary for servicing this audio system is the Bose PS321 service manual, which, however, is intended exclusively for warranty service stations or factory service, which means that any other activity on this item except for what was precisely intended in the owner's guide would void the warranty at the very least. The woofer module has its own amplifier, but this amplifier is muted per default to avoid uncontrolled dangerous sound emissions. It is the responsibility of the controlling unit, the media center, to activate the amplifier of the woofer when that is appropriate and safe. Without the controlling unit, it would be necessary to provide the signal that enables the amplifier, which is +5 volts, fed into the pin 13. Here is how the original documentation suggests to proceed, page 66, for the sole purpose of testing the woofer module independently. Considering that at pin 15 a source of +15 volts is available, they suggest building a simple resistor network to get the 5 volts from there and feeding the test signal between pin 6 and ground. This unit arrived with the original cable but cut at one end because someone already tried to figure out how to feed an audio signal to it, but without success. Under the circumstances, the first thing to do is to identify each single wire, numbering them according to the connector sequence. In this clip, the cable is connected to the unit, which, however, is initially turned off. This allows one to verify that the sequence of wire numbering is not reversed, finding all the ground wires with an ohm meter, easily identifiable because they are electrically joined together. Then the unit is turned on, and it is verified that there are 15 volts where it should be compared to ground. In this case, the voltage is also slightly higher than expected. The circuit proposed in the original documentation for testing the woofer is made up temporarily, and a signal generator is connected to terminal 6. The voltage obtained with the resistor network is tested, and then it is fed to pin 13. Only then, the signal can be heard from the loudspeaker as expected. Before making this modification permanent, it is important to verify if it would be appropriate to put a volume potentiometer. For example, what would happen if an audio cable were peaking home? How loud would that be reproduced? Considering that the cable was already ruined, instead of making an adapter using a D-sub plug, a small box is prepared for using it as a termination for the original cable. Here the box has been already drilled with suitable holes, and the cable is inserted, fixing it with zip ties. A small board is prepared with posts for all the individual wires of the cable. To make sure that there would be no accidental shorts between the posts while soldering the wires, the space between them is drilled. The two resistors are soldered on the board. Every single wire is soldered to its respective post on the board. The cable shield is not connected with the previously mentioned ground. Therefore, it is insulated and it will not be used. An RCA audio socket is installed on the box and connected. A test signal is provided through the RCA input, and the project is finished. After the experience, it is clear that preparing a D-sub plug adapter without reusing the original cable would have been way easier. While modifying an amplified loudspeaker, like it has been done in this project, one should pay attention to the fact that the speaker would become active at the time in which it is powered on. However, if in the meantime the speaker unit is already receiving a signal with relatively high volume, that would be immediately reproduced at power on, becoming potentially harmful. In other words, before feeding a signal to an amplified loudspeaker, one should make sure that the initial volume is very low, waiting for the loudspeaker unit to turn on before raising the volume.